A'uz billahi minash shaitan rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to another segment of our Ramadan series. In this series, we are looking at the teachings of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam with regards to the month of Ramadan and with regards to fasting. How can we learn from the traditions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam so that we have a successful month of Ramadan, inshallah. I am Yunus Hassan. I am a student of Al-Quran. I won the World Best Award for Community Service in Australia. And I took into consideration the idea or the need for us to have interfaith dialogue and cooperation. I've been working on interfaith dialogue and cooperation with other faiths within our communities. And due to my efforts, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it possible for me to win such prestigious award. Before we begin today's discussion, we'd like to look at our previous question and see what the answer is. Our previous question was, which of the prophets or prophets built the Kaaba? Which of the prophets or prophets built the Kaaba? We know that the Kaaba is in Makkah, where we usually go for our annual pilgrimage. That's for the Hajj, which is a pillar in Islam. So to go for the annual pilgrimage or to go for Hajj, it's a pillar in Islam for all those who can afford to go. If you cannot afford and you want to go for Hajj, it is best to seek the help and support of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah. If you don't go this year, but next year, you also be among those to attend the Hajj, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it possible for us. Now, it was Prophet Ibrahim and his son Ismail, they built the Kaaba. We understand from history where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed Prophet Ibrahim to build the Kaaba, where he was supported by his son Ismail or Ishmael. So afterwards, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked Prophet Ibrahim to call out to the world that they should come to the Kaaba for a pilgrimage. Up from then, we learn that as Muslims, we go to this holy land to perform our religious rites in a way of worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again, which is part of our deen or our faith. Now, going to Hajj, like we said, is a pillar of Islam, but for those who can afford. And again, we learn from the Quran in Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter 2 of Quran, where Allah is giving us a scenario or giving us a lesson there, that even though we are supposed to go there to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and seek his bounty, we are different in terms of our intentions when we go there. That some of those who go to Hajj, some will go there to seek the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just in this world, and some would seek the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this world and in the year after, and protection from the fire of Jahannam. That's to tell us that there are two different kinds of people or groups of people here when they go for Hajj. Some of us, our intention is that we just want the good or the bounty in this world. We don't care, or we are not worried about the year after. And some are worried about the year after, but they also want the good in this world. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us in Al-Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter 2 of Al-Quran, somewhere verse 200, towards verse 202, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم فمن الناس من يقول ربنا آتنا في الدنيا وما له في الآخرة من خلاق ومنهم من يقول ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار أولئك لهم نصيب مما كسبوا والله سريع الحساب.
Allah is telling us, فمن الناس من يقول ربنا آتنا في الدنيا وما له في الآخرة من خلق. That for some of those who go for Hajj, or those who are the Hajj pilgrimage, they seek the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this world, but they will not have any share in the year after. And for some of them, وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَكُولُ رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَكِينَ عَصَابَ النَّارِ. And for some of the people, they seek for good in this world and good in the hereafter and protection from the fire of Jahannam. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ نَسِيبٌ مِمَّا كَسَبُوا وَاللَّهُ سَرِيعُ الْحِسَابِ. And that these people, those who seek for the bounty in this world, bounty in the hereafter, and protection from the fire of Jahannam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He will give them what they've earned, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is quick in taking account. So this is a reminder to all of us that there's the need for us to be worried and concerned about good in this world, good in the hereafter, and protection from the fire of Jahannam. Of course, we have our differences, we have our different interests, but the best of it is that we should always pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for good in this world, good in the hereafter, and protection from the fire of Jahannam. It is a hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam where he talks about the popular dua that we should always make, which we've been hearing quite frequently, which is Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina azaban nar. It means we should always seek for good in this world, good in the hereafter, and protection from the fire of Jahannam. It's okay if you want good in this world, but you should understand that your concern should not just be about this world, and then you are just concerned about whatever luxury you can gather, whatever riches or wealth that you can gather. Of course, you can be a believer, you can be a Muslim, and perhaps that is your will. That's fine, but know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can give you that, but the hereafter, you might not have anything, and that is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us from this teaching. So let's come back again. As Muslims, we should not just concentrate in this world. Let's make sure that our efforts are also geared towards the hereafter. Now, scholars have tried to break this down, saying that رَبَّنَا أَتِنَا فِي دُنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ, that this is three in one. The dunya is 1/3, or 1/3, and the akhirah is 2/3, or 2/3. Meaning, the first part, which is this dunya, رَبَّنَا أَتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا, that is this the first part. And then, وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ, that is two, that is the hereafter. That means we want good in the hereafter, and then protection from the fire of Jahannam. So we should put more of our emphasis in the hereafter, because the hereafter is eternity. This world is only a short period of time for us. We might not live that long. So what is the gain that we'll get if we concentrate just in this world and forget the hereafter? Inshallah, that's just a brief reminder to us that the Prophet Ibrahim and his son, Prophet Ismail or Ishmael, were those who built the Kaaba, and they built it for the purpose of pilgrimage. And that's why Muslims today, we go to Hajj, or we go for Hajj every year in order to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One other lesson that we can learn with regards to the importance of the hereafter and not so much emphasis in this dunya is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Surah Al-Duha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والضحى والليل إذا سجى ما ودعك ربك وما قلى وللآخرة خير لك من الأولى ولسوف يؤتيك ربك فترضى ألم يجدك يتيما فآوى ووجدك ضالا فهدى ووجدك عائلا فأغنى فأما اليتيم فلا تقهر وأما السائل فلا تنهر وأما بنعمة ربك فحدث.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that وَالضُّحَى وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى وَلِلْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى. That وَالضُّحَى, by the glorious morning, as the day breaks, وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى, and as the night is still, your Lord has not forsaken you, nor is He displeased with you. وَلَلْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى. Indeed, the hereafter will be better or more favorable to the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ than this world. So from this, we understand it was a message that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ at a time where the disbelievers were mocking the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because it took quite a lot of time. It took quite a lot of time, a while, before the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had received another revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Initially, when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam received revelations, he preached it out to people. And it got to a time that for a very long time, the Prophet Muhammad SAW did not receive any revelation from Allah. So the people were in a way mocking him, or the disbelievers, that, "Ya Muhammad, O Muhammad, has your Lord forsaken you? Has he forgotten of you? You've not gotten another verse for us, or what is happening with your message? Has your message ceased," or something like that? So the Prophet was worried until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed these verses to him, that indeed he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has not forgotten him, that indeed he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has not forgotten him, nor is he displeased with him, but the hereafter will be better for him than this world. So from this, we understand that we should put our emphasis and our concentration the hereafter more than this world, because the hereafter will be eternity. That is where we are going to live without dying, inshallah. So for today's hadith, we are going to read from Sahih Bukhari, Book of Fasting, hadith number 34. It is narrated by Aisha and Salama that at times Allah's Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, used to get up in the morning in the state of janaba after having sexual relations with his wife. He would then take a bath and fast. From this hadith, we learn that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, during the month of Ramadan, or sometimes when he's fasting, he would, yes, have sexual relations with his wives, and then when he wakes up at dawn or at the early hours of the day, he would take his ritual bath and then fast. That's to tell us that when we are fasting and we have sexual relations with our wives, it is okay that during the month of Ramadan, you can go to your wives, or you can approach your wife. Because sometimes some people have this myth that in the month of Ramadan, they have to stay away from their wives. No, you have to stay away from your wife only when you are fasting, at the time you are holding the fast. That is during the day. Because from dawn, you start the fast, and at sunset, you break the fast or take your iftar. Then at night, you can approach your wife. Then the following day, if you've had sexual relations with your wife, you have to get up and then take your ritual bath and then begin another fast for the day. So from this hadith, that is what we learn from the narration by Aisha and Salama. And again, let's remember that Aisha was the wife of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Salama too was the wife of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is a narration by two of the wives. They are giving the testimony that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam would get up in the state of janaba, that is the impure state, when after having sexual relations with your wife. That kind of state, you are not in a state of purification, so you have to purify yourself by taking the ritual bath. Then you'll be purified, then you can then perform your religious obligations. Either you go for salah or start the fast. There's another hadith again that we can read from Sahih Bukhari, Book of Fasting, hadith number 35. It is narrated by Aisha. It's quite similar to this, that the Prophet used to kiss and embrace his wives while he was fasting, and he had more power to control his desires than any of you. So from here, we learn that Aisha radiallahu anha is telling that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to kiss his wives or embrace them, and he had more self-control. Because we understand that when we are fasting, we are not supposed to have sexual relations with our wives, but the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to kiss and embrace them, that which means that it is okay to kiss your wife and embrace them. But the case of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is different, because he could control himself. So if you know you cannot control yourself, don't even get close to that. Because sometimes kissing your wife or embracing them can influence you to go to the next level, that is to have sexual relations with them whilst you are fasting. And we understand from the previous studies or hadiths that we have to stay away from that whilst we are fasting. We are not supposed to have sexual relations with our wives. And at the other part of the hadith reads that this one is said by Jabir, that the person who gets discharged after casting a look on his wife should complete his fast. From this other part, we learn that sometimes you can have a look at your wife and then you have some sort of discharge from your private part, maybe an ejaculation or something. So if you have this situation, it doesn't mean that your fast is nullified. You should just continue your fast. But the most important thing is that don't have sexual relations with your wife whilst you are fasting, inshallah. We'd like to look at another hadith from Sahih Bukhari, Book of Fasting, hadith number 37. This one is narrated by Zainab, who is the daughter of Salama, that her mother said, so the wife of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Salama said, while I was lying with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when she was laying with him underneath a woolen sheet, I got the menstruation and then slipped away and put on the clothes which I used to wear in menses. He asked, what is the matter? Did you get your menses? I replied in the affirmative. That means she said yes, and then entered underneath that woolen sheet. I and Allah's Messenger used to take a bath from one water pot and used to kiss me while he was fasting. This another narration, this one from another wife of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Salama, that again the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to kiss her whilst he was fasting. And that this narration, she's telling us when she had her menses. So she used to put on some special clothes that would signal the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that she's in her menses. So he will not approach her. You know, when our wives are in their menses, it's not advisable in Islam to have sexual relations with your wife when she's having her menses. So from this narration, that's another lesson that we can get, that if your wife is having her menses, don't approach her sexually. From this narration, the wife of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Salama, she had some special clothes that she put on that would signal to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that she's having her menses. That way he will not make any approach or make any initiation towards having sexual relations with her. And she also confirmed at the other part of the hadith that she and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to bath from one water pot or maybe a bucket. They used to bath together in the bathroom. Again, this is another message of romance for us and our wives. It's important that we should encourage romance between us and our wives. There's no harm in bathing from the same water source or bucket with your wife in the bathroom. In fact, it's encouraged by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam from this hadith, that always try to do things with your wife that would enhance the love and the mercy between you. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to continue strengthening us in our struggles, our day in day out challenges. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us through. We pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should strengthen us in our iman and our sabr, our patience and perseverance. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us through. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease and goodness. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us good in this world, good in the hereafter, and protection from the fire of Jahannam. Before we go, we'd like to look at our question of the day, inshallah. And the question of the day is, what tribe did Prophet Muhammad belong to? What tribe did the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam belong to? Inshallah. Let's see how many of us can get it right at the comment section. The next time we come, we'll look at what the right answer is and then continue our discussion. Until next time, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.